Good morning and welcome to another service at One Faith, One Christ Church. We thank you for being here. We pray that God will bless you infinitely today. And we pray that the service will be something that will hold you and keep you. So we begin our call to worship. And again, this is where you are invited to praise God, where you're invited to worship God and give Him glory. So during this worship service, we're going to announce the songs, and you'll see them on the screen, but that doesn't stop you from joining in celebration of the music that serves to praise our Lord and God. So you can sing, dance, clap your hands, do whatever as you need to do to praise God. This is your time to give Him your praises, your time to ring out in joy and ring out in whatever it is that you need to express to God today. You do so. And this is a Palm Sunday. This is the week before Jesus dies on the cross, and He will do His triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And it's also our first communion, where we give thanks and remembrance for Jesus dying on our cross. So this is a big day. We've got a lot of things happening today, and that's just here with our communion service, with our palm service, and with you praising and worshiping God. So let's look at our scripture reading of this morning, Psalm 136. The one we usually begin our call to worship with, Psalm 136. And we'll read verses 1 through 3. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the God of gods, for His mercy endures forever. Oh, give thanks to the Lord of lords, for His mercy endures forever. And we thank God for His enduring mercy, because let's face it, we are guilty of sin. We are guilty and deserve the punishment that is due our sins. But God is enduring in mercy. God is enduring in grace. And He wants us to strive to be better, to do better things. And so because of that, we want to ensure that we give God the glory for all things and each and every thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31 says this: therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. To do all to the glory of God. And that's an important thing for us. Everything we need to do needs to be something that will represent or push forward the glory of God. Even if you're just doing your normal thing every day, it should be a representation of God, because you're doing so in a right manner. You're doing so in a right way. You're doing so with a righteous desire. So let us begin our worship service with "To God Be the Glory."
How can I say thanks for the things You have done for me? Things so undeserved, that You came to prove Your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, to Thee. To God
Yes, to God be the glory. And we want to give thanks to God for his goodness, for all the things that he has done for us. So our God is greater than all God, and Jesus' name is greater than all names. He has power to trample death and grave. He is undefeated. He was, is, and will always be undefeated by sin, by death, and by the grave. Our next song is Undefeated, presented by Marvin Sapp.
Infatuated with their own fame. Some self-proclaim they're the gold. History provides that my God's the one. No losses, he's won the most. Undefeated champion. So rise up, champion. We're victorious. Who is greater than? Nothing can defeat our God. Nothing can defeat us. Rise up, rise up. We're victorious. Say it again, say. Say it again, say. Rise up, rise up. We're victorious. I lost my job, but I did not lose my joy. I have hope in you. Stop you, nothing can defeat you. You reign, said you reign, King of Glory. Said you reign, King of Glory. Adonai, you live and sit on the throne.
Blessed we are to have a friend like Jesus in our life. He's a faithful friend who is always available 24/7. We can always come to him at any time to talk to him and to bring our problems to him. Jesus has said his yoke is easy and his burden is light. Lean on him and we will find rest for our souls. So let us celebrate what a friend we have in Jesus.
Jesus knows our every need. Friend we have in Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, what a friend we have in Jesus.
As we continue our praise and worship, we come to our second scripture of the morning, Psalm 138. So turn with us to Psalm 138. And this is a psalm for the goodness to us who are faithful to God. And we'll read verses 1 through 3. I will praise you with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing praises to you. I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name. For your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. In the day when I cried out, you answered me and made me bold with strength in my soul. Lord God, we come to you this morning. And we thank you, Father God, for every day of life that you've given us, Lord God, even though some of those days were not their best and some of those days were trying and tough. But yet you saw us through to this day, Father God, with the hope that things will be different, things will be better, things will be renewed. So, Father, we pray that you'll forgive us, Heavenly Father, of our transgressions and allow us, Father God, to grow before you, to continue to try and walk, Lord God, in that path of righteousness. Not that we're righteous, Lord God, but we want to walk that path of righteousness. So help us, Heavenly Father, to achieve those goals, to achieve the desires of our hearts, Heavenly Lord God. Help us, Heavenly Father, to become that child of God that you want us to be, to do the work that you've called us to do, to be a vocal piece for Lord Jesus in this day and age. And so, Lord God, we pray that you'll help us, Heavenly Father, as we struggle through some illnesses. Lord, bring healing to those, Heavenly Father, who are sick at this moment, who are not feeling their best, whose health has declined a bit. Father God, raise that health bar back up. Raise that health issue out of their bodies, Lord God, to remove it from them, Heavenly Father, to give them, Heavenly Father, a renewal again, to take away whatever malady that is lying inside them, Father God, and replace it, Lord God, with nothing but your goodness and grace. And help those, Heavenly Father, who are impacted by the financial issues of the day. Lord, we pray that you will give them new opportunities, open doors of jobs and open doors of promotion. So for those, Heavenly Father, who are seeking positions, Lord God, we pray that you give them the favor of companies that will want to have them work in their facilities. And for those, Heavenly Father, who are working and looking, Father God, to increase their careers and grow a bit more in their job, Father God, we pray for a boost for them, that you'll give them favor with their managers, their supervisors, that you'll lift them up a little bit more. And Father God, for those, Heavenly Father, who are retired and living on a fixed income, Heavenly Father, we pray that you will allow that money to be stretched and to make ends meet more and more. And Father God, look upon those, Heavenly Father, today that you're bringing forth to this service. Father God, enrich their lives, Lord, that they see and know that Jesus is living and working in their lives. Give us all an understanding of the living Christ that we serve. Give us all an understanding of the blood that he shed on the cross for our sins to deliver us from the hands of the evil one. And Lord, we just continue to look upon you for our strength. And as we shout out boldly today, Heavenly Father, help us to do something that glorifies you, Lord God, in our next step of the day. Father God, we just thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We have our next song, which for some reason I lost the paper for it. It's okay. I know what the song is. There's a scripture that says we should both hope and wait on the Lord. Hope, I say, wait, I say, on the Lord. That's what we need to do. We need to sometimes just stop doing stuff because we just can't be patient. We just can't wait for something to turn around or something to turn about. The psalmist says it is good that we hope and wait on the Lord. And then at the end he says, wait. Yes, it's Isaiah. I'm getting direction from the congregation here. Yes, I know where it is. I just didn't say the scripture. It's good for us to hope and wait on the Lord. Wait, I say, on the Lord. So our next song deals with that particular subject, to wait on the Lord. The song is just titled, Wait.
Times are up when times are down. He's never let me down. let it go. I'm still standing, and I've learned how to trust and wait on Jesus. Oh, I know he will give me the power, so I keep the faith and know the joy will come. When things are good, when things are bad, when I'm happy, when I'm sad, I'm going to wait on the Lord. Oh, when times are up, when times are down,
sorry about that. Got so many things I got to change and turn on. So as we come to our tithes and offerings, time to give back a little bit to the Lord that he has blessed you with. If you're in a sanctuary anytime, come up and put your tithes and offerings in the pot there. And for those on the other side of our camera, if you want to send your tithes and offerings to this church, there is our website. If you're watching this on an archive or on another platform, Facebook, Odyssey, Yahoo, all of those other ones, you can go to our website, www.onefaithonechrist.org, and press the give button and provide your tithes and offerings that way. Or if you want to use Zelle on your bank account, use info@onefaithonechrist.org for the name, and that will hook your account up to ours and allow you to provide your tithes and offerings that way as well. Or if you like, you can send them to the church direct at 1327 East Muritania Street, Wilmington, California, 90744. As well as that is our address that we use to congregate at on Sunday mornings, so you can also come into the church as well. We just thank you for your giving. And again, the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Be really cheerful in your giving. Now, I'm just going to say that. When you give, give for no other reason that you want to give to the Lord. Okay? There's no obligations involved in giving. There's no obligations involved in tithing. God says you do this from your own heart. You do this in the way that you so desire. So, Father God, we just thank you for this time of offering. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your wonderful blessings upon each and every one of us. So bless this offering and bless each and every one who has given today. Bless them immensely, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, our next song this morning, I have to tell you that when I do watch TV, I don't really watch anything that's new out there in the networks today. I usually watch other channels like Freevee or something like that. And I watch old shows, some shows that I haven't seen in a long time. Yeah, I like watching reruns of things, reran again. And I ran across this show that I'd never seen before, and it was back in 2008. And it was basically a show about God, but they kind of mix it in with lawyers and God. And you may wonder, how's that going to work? Lawyers are considered to be less than honest individuals. But this one, God impressed upon this lawyer by ways of visions to get him to do certain things or act upon certain things. But this lawyer, being that he's a lawyer, didn't want to do these things. He fought against God every time. Even though the vision sometimes made him go and be there, again, the mysteries of God, you know, he ended up doing whatever God wanted, but he didn't really know he was doing, didn't want to do it. And so it finally came to a few episodes in, and God actually met him, not by way of we thinking God looks, but by way of his father who had passed away. And basically his father is like asking him, so why don't you just do what I ask? Why do you always want to fight against me? He says, why are you going against the grain? When I give you these visions, they're for a good reason, they're for a good purpose. Why can't you just say yes and get it done? That's us too, sometimes. God wants us to do something. He moves in our lives, but we won't say yes. We don't want to. We want to do things our way. We want to move in our direction. We want to move in whatever we feel is appropriate. So the next song is just simply, say yes.
When Jesus says, nobody.
Now we come to our word of the day. The message for this Palm Sunday. So turn with me to Mark chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. Mark 11, verses 1 through 11. Now, when they drew near Jerusalem to Bethage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and as soon as you have entered it, you will find a coat tied on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it. And if anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it,' and immediately he will send it here." So they went their way and found the coat tied by the door outside on the street, and they loosed it. But some of those who stood there said to them, "What are you doing, loosening the coat?" And they spoke to them just as Jesus had commanded. So they let them go. Then they brought the coat to Jesus and threw their clothes on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their clothes on the road, and others cut down leafy branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then those who went before and those who followed cried out, saying, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." And Jesus went into Jerusalem and into the temple. So when he had looked around at all things, as the hour was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So as we look at Palm Sunday, we need to understand something. What Jesus did that morning. And we have to know that this is what he did. The Messiah announced. He announced himself in this very spectacular way, very public way. He announced himself as the Messiah. So over 2,000 years ago, the Sadducees had a tradition. They believed the Messiah would show up 4 days before Passover. And remember, Jesus died on the cross on Passover. They kept the gates of the temple open so that he could walk right into his rightful place. Hebrew nationalistic fever was always at a peak on this day, Palm Sunday. The Romans would have all the troops on high alert on this day. They feared another revolt would be attempted, led by a religious radical. As had happened in the past, tensions were high. So on this day, Jesus brought tensions to a high. But again, he didn't do this. This normally happened because they were always waiting for their Messiah to come. And the people of Jerusalem knew their scripture well, and on that day, 4 days before Passover, I'm sure the following scripture would have come into the people's mind. Let's look at Zechariah chapter 9, verses 8 through 9. Zechariah 9, 8 through 9. "I will camp around my house because of the army, because of him who passes by and him who returns. No more shall an oppressor pass through them, for now I have seen with my eyes. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now, I want to say something that we overlook in this passage. Our passage, the opening passage of Mark. Jesus told his disciples to go into an opposite city and find a donkey that was tied up that had no one set, that never been ridden before. Sometimes we miss this omniscience of Jesus. He was able to see and know that there will be this donkey, that a young donkey that had never been tied up before, they call it a colt, that had never been ridden by anyone. He says that's the one he needs. And again, we got to look at the provisions of God, the providence of God, how that colt was set there in such a way that Jesus would know about it, since he is God in the flesh. He would know because he positioned it there. So sometimes we miss that when we go in this scripture and deal with Palm Sunday. We miss the power of Jesus there, how he sees something without actually having been there to know that it was there, as you and I would. I would not be able to make that prediction. I would have to go in that city and see first, oh, there's a coat tied up. And I would have to question people, has anyone ever ridden that coat before? And they would tell me no. And then now I go back to my disciples. I said, okay, in that city, there's a coat that has never been ridden before. But then Zechariah, the people thought this was basically a military cry, that the Messiah would come in and remove the Roman oppression that's going on. So the Palm Sunday, and if you are a part of our Bible studies, you'll find out that Jesus did not do anything in Jerusalem while he was doing his earthly ministry until the last of it. Most of it he stayed in Judea and in Galilee further up. But now he comes into Jerusalem because this is his, what they call a Passion Week. This is when Jesus triumphantly enters into Jerusalem and does what the Bible says he will do. Go up to the temple, coming in on a donkey, a colt, a young foal of a donkey. So this is the day that Jesus enters Jerusalem, riding on a colt. The day as predicted by Zechariah. Now Jesus would have been riding and coming from a place called Bethany. The Mount of Olives he would have gone by, riding across what's called the Kidron Valley. Now, this is not actually a valley, but it's more like a really steep canyon. So he's basically coming through a canyon, but we call it the Kidron Valley. He would have ridden across and right past the original city King David had built, which is now and was then outside the city wall. So if you ever get a chance to go to Jerusalem, the city of Jerusalem is actually walled in. But outside of it, there's another little city, and they call that the city of David. So he would have ridden past that, and coming up the ridge, he would have been right outside the city wall where the temple would have directly been sitting behind the wall. By far the most prominent structure in that time. Today, if you go to Jerusalem, you will see there's something called the Dome of the Rock. And it is the most prominent feature. It's a Muslim temple. And it's an Islamic holy site having been built over the ruins of the original temple. Now, if you've seen the pictures of Jerusalem, this large gold dome also stands out. Right there is where Jesus was entering the city 4 days before Passover on a colt right outside the temple. So just as Zechariah said, the Messiah would come into, and just as the religious leaders and the Jewish people believed, 4 days before, the Messiah would come into the temple. What a scene this must have been. Can you imagine how people were? For as long as anyone can remember, There has been this tradition that 4 days before Passover, the Messiah would come on a coat. And here is Jesus, 4 days before, on a coat, clearly headed toward the temple. So the people must go crazy. They set out branches in front of him to honor him and make the way before him beautiful. The Messiah announced. But the Jewish leaders don't seem to recognize this. Comes in on the foal of a donkey, a colt, goes right up into the temple, just as Scripture prophesied. But the Jewish leaders don't recognize this. Like them today, we are blind to the works of Jesus. They were blind to that. They took no notice. And we are also today blind to the works of Jesus, to the announcement of his glory by dying on the cross for our sins. Now, when I say we, I'm not saying everybody, but I'm going to speak in the most general sense is that a lot of us have not accepted the death and burial and resurrection of Jesus, let alone that the religious leaders didn't accept or recognize that their Messiah walked up right into the temple, just as prophecy said. Now, there were many visitors in Jerusalem at that time, which was and is traditional at Passover. As we're coming up to Passover, yes, Jerusalem is going to be overcrowded. For us, it would be like the crowds in Times Square just before New Year's Day. So if you want to get a picture of how Jerusalem is going to be bursting at the seams with people, think about Times Square, New York. Now, a lot of us aren't there, but we do watch it on TV, and we watch the ball come down with the timer. And you see those huge throngs of people there. Now, many of these visitors would walk to the temple with branches in hand to worship in Jerusalem. As pilgrims walked to the temple for worship, they would sing songs. One of them, well known to all, was Psalm 118, which is what they say to Jesus as he enters the city. They literally say in Hebrew, "Lord, please save us. Lord, please save us." And that's what we need to shout as well, "Lord, please save us." But were the people just getting caught up in the emotion of the day? You know, you can get in this, what they call this lynch mentality, where you get caught up in the activity. You're not really into it. You don't really know what's happening, but you're caught up in the emotion of this activity. So they're caught up in the emotion of the day, quoting a favorite psalm as Jesus rode by. Is that what they're doing? Are they just there? A spontaneous parade of sorts for Jesus? Is this what the people are doing? Is that what we're doing sometimes? Just a spontaneous parade of sorts? For Jesus, this must have been a bittersweet time. For it truly was prophecy being fulfilled, and he truly was the promised Messiah, and truly he deserved the praise offered him. But many of the same people excited about his entry into the city this day are the same ones that mock him as he walks with a cross on his back through the city of Jerusalem on his way to death just a few days later. And Jesus would know who those people were. So are we caught up in the emotion of things where we cheer and rejoice in Jesus today? But when it comes down to us having to do something for Jesus, you know, I'm busy. I got something else to do. So why is everyone so excited about Jesus and then either ambivalent or against him? So they start out excited, and then all of a sudden either it doesn't matter or they just outright don't like him. Well, at first, they had great expectations of Jesus. They praised him for two reasons. One, he performed miracles. Just before he arrived in Jerusalem, he had raised Lazarus from the dead. And you know, word had gotten around about that, how he risen Lazarus from the dead. Number two, they saw him as one who could make their life better by freeing them from the political opposition of the Romans. Jesus does not perform any miracles for people after he enters the city of Jerusalem. No more miracles after that, because now it's just him preparing his disciples for his death on the cross. So no more miracles are being done. His teaching is serious and tough for many to hear. There was even, as we studied in John, he talked about that his body was, or the flesh was what we were going to eat, his flesh. And people are like, man, this is just too tough for us to deal with. We can't handle this. It's just, as they say, it's above my pay grade. And they left. He teaches mostly on submission and commitment. And I'm telling you now, submission is tough. And if we look at our relationships around the world, commitment is another tough thing. We just can't seem to commit to anything nowadays. Everything is temporal. All of our commitments, our promises are all temporal. They don't mean a thing. And this is what Jesus teaches mostly on, submission and commitment. Not a message that people expected the Messiah to teach. This was not supposed to be what the Messiah was going to teach. The Messiah was going to come in and teach military tactics, teach ways of getting back our city. And they wanted to know how he was going to make life easier. They wanted to hear about getting rid of the problem, the Romans. Jesus didn't talk about that at all. Jesus did not come to make life better and to deal with life problems, but not in the way they expect. So I think I used the word not there. Actually, I should have said Jesus did come to make life better and to deal with life's problems, but not in the way they expect, and not in the way we expect either. Jesus doesn't come to give us a life's philosophy or to be a great example to follow. He doesn't even come to make us a good people. He comes to deal with the burden of sin that has infected our life, that has caused us such grief, hurting our relationships, creating distance between those we love, leaving us empty, and with that comes submission and commitment to God. And in the changing of our hearts, we don't become good people, we become better people. Still flawed and sinful, but saved on the road to redemption. Now, Jesus went through a whole bunch of stuff about who's good and who's not good. He says, no one's good. Only the Father is good. So we can't sit back and say that we're going to be good people. Jesus is not going to make us good people. He's going to make us better than we are, okay? Jesus is wonderful when he comes to make life easier to bear, but it becomes a different matter when submission and commitment come into play. So that's one thing to make your life a little easier, to make your life a little more bearable. But if you have to submit and commit to do so, that's when you start to fall out. That's when we start to lose it. But that's what Jesus says. You're going to submit and commit if life is going to be a little more bearable. And just think about it. Because you're not submitting, you're not committing, you now have an internal angst. You now have an internal anger. You now have an internal issue. Life is not better. Because you right now are not a state where you think life is good. Just because you won't submit or commit. In 2006, Rosie O'Donnell was being interviewed. Now, you know Rosie, the former talk show host and constant target of Donald Trump. When asked if she thought God would be disappointed with her when she stands before him after she dies, she answered this way. God ought to be happy. I'm doing the best I can. Well, to be fair to Rosie, what she says seems fair. I mean, what better could I do than the best I can? And we think about that. What better can I do than the best I can? To some degree, couldn't any one of us here stand before God and claim that? Is that what we're going to claim to God? I did the best I could. God, give me a break. I'm doing the best I can. Sounds like something our kids would say. Dad, give me a break. I'm trying to do this. Do you really think that this is going to be the criteria God will consider? That you can just stand there and say you did the best you could? I'm going to say this. Get serious. Sophia Loren was being interviewed back in 1999, and the interviewer asked her if she was religious and what she thought of God. And she replied, "Well, I'm not really into it. I'm not a very religious person, but I should go to heaven. I haven't done anything wrong. My conscience is clean. My soul is as white as orchids. I should go straight to heaven." Quite different than Rosie O'Donnell's response. Rosie O'Donnell says, "God, you should be happy." Sophia Loren says, "I'm perfect. I should go. Not a problem." I think, especially in America, most people would echo Sophia Loren's words in one way or another. Yeah, we'll echo that. Yeah, I'm good. I did good. I've been a good person. I should go straight to heaven. There should be nothing that keeps me from getting there. What about the people who welcomed Jesus one day and cursed him the next? Or worse still, ignored him and went on with their life as Jesus was condemned to death? They ain't doing anything wrong, did they? They just went on about their business. Jesus dying over there ain't got nothing to do with me. Weren't they doing the best they could? Oh, yeah. They were doing their best. I'm avoiding that. That's the best I can do right now. I mean, they all had obligations to fulfill. Couldn't they say to themselves, like Sophia, "I haven't done anything wrong. My conscience is clear"? After all, how could they possibly be aware of the direct result their actions would have? How could they know? And so, that we know, we want to look at what Paul says about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. 1 Corinthians 4, 1 through 4. "Let a man so consider us as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that one be found faithful. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by a human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself, for I know of nothing against myself, yet I am not justified by this, but he who judges me is the Lord." We easily fool ourselves. A clear conscience really isn't relevant. Just because you have a clear conscience doesn't mean a thing. After all, many Nazis went to their grave with clear consciences. Many other killers and murderers went to their grave with clear consciences because they thought they were doing the right thing. They thought they were doing stuff that was correct. I remember I told my son that I knew an individual who shot a waitress because she didn't serve his eggs the right way. He shot her. And his rationale was, she's incompetent. She doesn't need to be on the face of this earth. He believed he was doing the right thing. And then to further realize that that was not an oddity, about a week ago, I saw a news article where another man shot a Subway worker because she put too much mayo on his sandwich. And he thought he was doing the right thing. Why? Because she shouldn't have put that much mayo on my sandwich. What I did was justified. So we see, when you think you have this clean conscience, that clean conscience can be made up of anything. You can rationalize all kinds of things away. Just because my conscience is clear, that offers me no innocence. I'm not innocent. Those two individuals, even though their conscience was clear, they did something they thought was right and justified. They were not innocent. And when I consider Rosie O'Donnell's theological standpoint, that God ought to be pleased that I am doing the best I can, I've got to tell you, from a biblical perspective, it just doesn't hold water. Just doing the best one can just doesn't hold water. Because the best one can is subjective. Is God looking for us to do the best we can? Not once in the life and ministry of Jesus did he tell anyone, it's okay, you're doing the best you can. Remember the woman who was caught red-handed in adultery when Jesus asked them, whoever is without sin, cast the first stone. They were going to kill her by throwing huge rocks to stone her to death. Jesus steps in and saves her from death. But when he turns and speaks to her, go and do the best you can. Remember that scripture? When Jesus tells the people, he is without sin, cast the first stone, and they all departed because they realized their sin was just the same. Jesus tells her, go and do the best you can. No, he doesn't say that. Jesus says, go and sin no more. Quite different than doing the best you can. Go and sin no more is what he said to her. In fact, this is what Jesus tells people over and over again. He doesn't expect our best effort. He expects what effort we put into it, that it is the best we can do with faith in him. The best we can with Jesus powering our efforts. Remember that little mustard seed can grow into a huge tree? Jesus is not like a tennis coach. Good effort in that last game. Good effort in your life. No. He says that with his help and your steadfast walk with him, you can do better. Now, I know some people are sitting back there and saying, wow, if I can't do my best, how can I make it? Like I said, the problem with doing your best is you decide what best is. There are some people who give up on jobs because they believe they're doing their best. They're putting in their best effort. But their best effort's falling short because they've created ways to not do real best, but to do what they believe is the best. And this is where God is saying to us, and Jesus is saying to us, your best isn't good enough because you don't realize the true potential of yourself. We sometimes don't realize our own true potential. And like I started out with that TV show with that lawyer who just would not accept God, God was trying to show him a greater potential than he was. But all he can see was he was a lawyer. That was his best. God was saying, you can be your lawyer and be something more. And the term prophet started to come up in this show. But he didn't want to do that. His best is a lawyer. I've worked hard. I went to school, everything, lawyer. I'm the best. But Jesus says there's beyond best. So don't get dismayed when I'm talking about best is not good enough. Your best is when Jesus moves you forward to do greater and better things. We get caught up on where we are, our titles, our current positions. I'm the best at this right now. Jesus says, no, there's more. There's better. And so, if a God who is happy with me doing the best I can is not the kind of God I need God to make me do better. So if God's only happy with my best, then no, that's not a God I want. If this is what we expect our whole perspective, then it's off. If we think God's going to be all fine, you did your best. The problem is that we are doing the best we can. And like I said, that comes down to you individually. The best you can. The best we can without the Holy Spirit guiding us. And that's what God wants. That's what Jesus wants. He says that's why he'll send the Comforter to guide us and direct us. But if we do our best, we're not listening to the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit's saying, no, I got something more for you. No, I've done my best. And I remember once in a service, and I may have mentioned this before, at when we were talking about going to do something else after our service. And this one woman says, oh, I'm done with my worship for today. I'm going to go watch basketball. Her best was that. She did her best. She's done. Now she's going to start another best with basketball. So if we don't allow the Holy Spirit to guide us, then we're not doing our best that Jesus wants. We're doing the best that we want. And this goes back to Palm Sunday, much like the people waving branches as Jesus passed by. They were doing their best, but that wasn't the best Jesus wanted. You see, the best you relies on you and you alone. But in Christ, we can do much better. Scripture says, I can do all things in Christ Jesus who strengthens me. I have limitations as this physical human being. But Jesus says, I can stretch that limitation. I can push that limitation to new bounds. But if you say that's your best, then okay, then you're left there. But in Christ Jesus, we can do much better. It is not about doing the best I can, leading a Dr. Phil prescribed life. We don't need personal self-help gurus, personal self-help books, or even help with our past life experiences. Now, yes, people have gone through this, and I ran across this, and I mentioned this, past life gurus giving you understanding of how you can review your past lives. I was in a bookstore the other day. Yes, we do have bookstores in the city I live in. Yes, we do. I know everything is now no longer brick and mortar. Everything is Amazon and online, but we do have a bookstore. It's a very nice bookstore. And I say very nice because it's cluttered. Books falling off shelves and stuff like that. Me, that's good. I like that because it looks well-traveled, well-used. While there, I picked this card up, and it reads, Dr. Mark Cohen, Ph.D., specialist in guided imagery, is the only person trained and qualified to work as a between lives therapist. Now, first of all, that caught me off guard. If he's the only person trained and qualified, then that means the person who trained him isn't qualified. If he's the only one, unless his trainer died. But that's a pretty bold statement to make, that he is the only one trained and qualified to work as a life between lives therapist. But isn't that great? You got someone that can help you walk between lives and understand your transitions as you've gone through the spiritual life. Now, I'm going to say this. It's not biblical at all. But we got people who are calling themselves PhDs, and they are qualified to do this kind of stuff. And so I love this kind of stuff. And then there was a description that he had on his card. Life between lives, spiritual regressions begin with a two-hour session in which you can recall a significant past life. Fascinating. After this, in one four-hour session, you can recall in great detail your experiences as a soul between incarnations. So, two-hour sessions, you can just deal with finding out past life. Give me 4 hours, and I'll help you walk through and see how you've gone from one incarnation to another. And you can meet your spiritual guides and also the people closest to you as they appear as eternal souls. This is a pretty bold statement for this man. He's going to say that, I'm going to tell you all your lives that you've been through if you give me 4 hours. But if you only pay for 2 hours, I can't go that far. And so, now when you're looking at these eternal souls that you've met in previous lives, are they thinner, better looking? And he says, for the first time, you will be able to understand why you chose your present incarnation with all its challenges. And so I was really stuck there. He says, so you're saying my other incarnations basically gave me guide and direction of why and who I am today. Yeah, right. If that were the case, how come I didn't pick the Arnold Schwarzenegger kind of body today instead of my dad body I have right now? So you're saying that all my choices and all my decisions in those past lives didn't make me any smarter, any wiser. What was I thinking back in those other regressions? So again, I'm mentioning that to show you that we can use that as the limitations for our best. Oh, my past lives prevented me from getting to be the person I needed to be because I made some mistakes back then and they're still haunting me to this very day in this very life. I'm just trying to hone the fact that our best is limited by us. My mom made a very clear statement to me when I kind of mentioned that some people were holding me back, some people were keeping me from doing something and keeping me from whatever. My mom's very clear statement for me was this. The only one that can keep you from getting to where you need to be is you. And that stuck with me. And that is true. Really, some people may interfere with your progression. You may not get a job you think that you should get. You may not move up a ladder that you may think you do, but nobody's preventing you really but you. Because you can always sidestep that by going to another job and finally climbing up the ladder. It's on you, okay? People can interfere, but they really can't prevent you. And that's why I'm not really happy with all of this stuff that we're talking about, black lives and racism and all this other stuff, because we're keeping ourselves down. As a black man, we're keeping ourselves down. We have all the opportunities that are there if we don't sit back and say, well, I'm just doing the best I can. No, you can do better. I remember first church I pastored, the people complained because the neighborhood now was being overrun with a lot of Koreans buying up businesses around the church. And they were mad. Our congregation was mad. Koreans keep buying up our place. They keep taking our stuff. I said, why don't you go out and start a business? What's stopping you from buying a place as well? Nothing. Sitting here complaining and moaning and griping is not going to get you that business. Those Koreans have put in the effort. And they bought that business. And they're going to do something with it. So instead of sitting here saying, well, I'm doing my best, sitting here crying and complaining to you, go out and start a business. That wasn't well received. So So I wanted to go to this office, this individual, this man, who Dr. Cohen, and just see who was walking in and who was walking out. Who falls for this stuff is what I wanted to see. I really wanted to find out what kind of people are into past life regressions and believing that their previous lives helped or hindered this life. Now, before I go any further, let me tell you this. The Bible does not talk about second lives, third lives, fourth lives. God says you got one life, and then there's a judgment. There is no multiple. You got one. And so what I love the most about these reincarnation people is that when they find out about your past lives, you were always a princess or a prince, a great warrior or such. Always something romantic. Have you noticed that? Well, have you gone and done that? Have you seen other people and dealt with other people? I was always something magnificent and great. Well, then how did I end up now not being so great? I'm not a prince in some country. Here I am, a janitor in this company. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a janitor, as I told my son, nothing wrong with that. But still, you're thinking coming from princedom down to being commanded by your CEO at some company, or even yet further down that you're being supervised by some person who doesn't really know what the heck they're doing. I used to be a prince. What happened? What mistake did I make that now brought me down to the depths of this? Those people in the past lives are never an accountant or a truck stop bus boy or even a duck. Because that, my friends, is boring. I'm not going to pay you for 4 hours to sit back and tell me, hey, you used to be a secretary or you used to be a phone answer person. You used to be a duck. No, you got to tell me that I was a prince, that I was a king, that I was somebody special. Oh, I'll pay you $4 or 4 hours for that. And like I said, to tell me that I was something other, that wasn't so magnificent or romantic, is boring. And as a past life therapist, you will never get folks to come for a second session if your story isn't romantic. So we're not doing the best we can because our previous life we were a prince. So apparently you're not doing the best you can because you're not a prince today. You haven't gotten higher than a prince, so you're not doing your best. So looking back on that day, some 2,000 years ago when Jesus, when the people lined the streets and were thrilled with Jesus, you know they were doing their best they could with what they had, and you know the commitment and submission Jesus spoke about. Well, they weren't ready for it. They weren't doing the best they can. Let me take this a step further. We can judge the crowds because they turned away from Jesus. Someone says, oh, don't judge me. I can. You turned away. I'm not judging you by means of bringing you into condemnation, but because you turned away, Jesus says you are in condemnation. But everyone did. Everyone turned away. All of Jesus' friends, all of Jesus' disciples, everyone was his friend the day he rode into the city, but he died alone and despised days later. People stood afar off and watched him die on the cross. His mother was there, or as we know from Scripture, his mother was there, another Mary was there, John the disciple was there, but nobody really did anything to stop this. Not that they could. They didn't even do the best they could. He died alone and despised days later. Even though people were around him, he died alone. Even though there were two thieves on the cross with him, he died alone. No one was a hero. Everyone failed. No one, even those Jesus healed, even those who Jesus protected, even those Jesus raised from the dead, it turns out not one of them did the best they could. Now, this is one of those cases where they couldn't. There was nothing they could do about this. But the Bible shows that they did nothing at all. So was that their best, to do nothing? And that, my friends, is good news for us, that they did nothing, that they were unable to do anything. That's good news for us. Because Rosie O'Donnell is wrong. God isn't looking for those who are doing the best they can do. God isn't interested in something so bureaucratic. God is looking for people who can recognize that they have broken lives and can recognize that they need healing. That's what God wants. Paul says that in his weakness, he is made strong through Christ Jesus. So God needs us to realize that we need healing. God wants us to realize that we are broken and we're not at our best. That they need forgiveness in their lives. He's not looking for people who can make it. Those kinds of people think they don't need God. If I'm doing my best and God doesn't need it, I'm doing my best. God has no place in my life. I got it, man. I'm handling this. I'm managing this. God, I don't need you. I'm doing my best. The Messiah announced should show us our weaknesses and show us the reason we need to turn to him. That's what the point is, to recognize our weaknesses and to see that we need a Savior. You know what? I spoke this morning to someone several times about the death of Jesus, and that is a powerful thing, an awesome thing. But the resurrection of Jesus, there is power. There is real transformation because he was transformed. His body was transformed. And not only him, but all of his friends, all of his disciples, but one, many of the Pharisees and Sadducees who condemned him to death, and thousands of those who lined the streets waving branches as Jesus passed by and later betrayed him, they became fervent followers of Jesus Christ after his resurrection, and for they experienced a great forgiveness from God. So that's what I mean by the transformation. Before that, they abandoned him. They despised him. They mocked him. And openly, the Sadducees and the Pharisees mocked him. But after his resurrection, some of those very same Sadducees and Pharisees, so for you, Sadducees and Pharisees are the highest religious leaders in Jewish history at that time. But some of them were transformed. Some of them were changed because Jesus rose again. Such a great power, such a great awakening that even when thousands threatened with death, they would not back down. So that was one of the things about Jesus' disciples after his resurrection. They were tortured and they were told to, if you denounce Christ, we'll let you go. They couldn't. They would not back down. Now, would you back a lie? Would you back a lie to save your life? If you knew that what Jesus had did in his lifetime, what he had did in his ministry, and that he died on the cross, rose again, would you believe that a lie? Or would you, like these individuals, go to their death believing that Jesus was the Messiah? They wouldn't back down because now they could rely on someone greater than themselves. They now know that the best they can do is greater than that because Jesus Christ died and defeated death. They had the mighty power of the Holy Spirit. It was clear they couldn't do it on their own. They couldn't do their best. They can now do better. They tried on the day of Jesus' triumphant entry and failed a few days later. They were triumphant as well, recognizing Jesus as the Messiah who walked up onto the temple. But after that, they're like, nope, sorry, that wasn't the dude. That wasn't the guy. We were mistaken. But now, after the resurrection, it's not about you or am I doing the best we can, but about the Spirit of God coming upon us, doing the best he can and he does for us. So again, you realize that with God, nothing is impossible. So if nothing is impossible with God, then your best is infinite. Your best is much greater than you can even imagine. Like I told you about that show, about that lawyer. He thought his best ended at being a lawyer. God's saying, no, your best is unfathomable. You cannot imagine how best you can be with me leading you on. And so that's us. We need to realize that our best isn't good enough. God's best is sufficient. The Messiah announced, Jesus announced himself. And as we read our scriptures today and as we study the Word of God, he continues to announce himself. Will you believe the announcement? Not be like the people back then that believed him when he came into to Jerusalem, walked up to the temple, but then the next day, they're like, I'm sorry. That was a mistake. That's on you. You get to figure that out. Are you going to believe? He's already made his announcement. Will you believe that announcement? And so, for you, if you believe that announcement, then there's a choice you have to make. But as I'm saying, if you believe the announcement, the choice is simple. Will you accept Christ Jesus into your life so that he can propel you beyond your best to make it into his best? So that he can make you better than what you are right now. If you'd like to accept Christ Jesus and make that change and make that leap forward, I'm going to offer you a prayer to ask him to come into your heart. And this is a prayer, this is personal between you. Even though I'm going to give you the words to say, that doesn't stop you from adding on to it in any way you feel works for you. So I'm just giving you a prayer formula. And like any formula, you may find that it may differ for you. It may need something more. I'm not saying it'll need less. It may need more for you. So I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If you want to accept Christ Jesus so that you can now realize your true potential, to start seeing your true goals, to say yes to Jesus Christ, follow this prayer. Wherever you're at, like I said, if you're doing something with heavy machinery, driving cars, flying planes, operating trains, whatever, put someone else in control of that while you pray for the acceptance of Christ Jesus. So wherever you're at, bow your head and pray this prayer and mean it from the heart to accept Christ Jesus in your life so that you can be your better best. Father God in heaven, forgive me of my sins. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus, to die for me. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for shedding your blood so that I can be redeemed. Come into my heart and make me the person you want me to be. Thank you for accepting me. In your name I pray. Amen. Now, if you prayed that, welcome to the body of believers. Welcome to the church. Now, I'm not talking about this physical church that we're in right now. The church is the body of believers. Jesus said he will come and take his church. And that will include those physical churches who are proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ, as well as you who are on the other side of our camera here in our church facility proper. We'll join in to be the bride of Jesus Christ. And so now that you're starting on your journey, we want to help out at this church by, one, giving you a place that you want to come to and congregate at. We do this 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time on Sundays at 1327 East Muritania Street, Wilmington, California, 90744. You're always welcome. Our doors will be open for you. Come and join us. And our website, www.onefaithonechrist.org. If you're not already on it, then you can go there and find information about this church, contact numbers for the church itself, as well as myself. You can have a direct line to me anytime you need for resources, for with information, if you just need to want to pray or want to talk, have some concerns. I'm the pastor here, and I will help you out. And if there are issues other than I can handle, then the Lord's going to provide somebody for you. If you're a woman and have issues and things, we have somebody here who's certified in Christian counseling, and they can help you out. So the Lord's going to provide as long as you want the help. So we're here to help you. Our email address is info@onefaithonechrist.org. Drop us a line and let us know if you need anything, Bibles, resources. We can help you out. Questions, comments, just let us know. That's our email address, and we're happy to hear from you. And we want to help you out. If you need a Bible, let us know, and we'll send one to you. And speaking on Bibles, we have our Bible studies on Fridays and Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. We do those via Zoom meeting. And if you want to be a part of our Bible studies, send us an email at info@onefaithonechrist.org, and I'll send you the Zoom link. The one link works for both Fridays and Wednesdays. On Wednesdays, we're doing the book of John, and I think we're chapter 8. Yeah. And on Friday, this Friday, we're starting in the book of Matthew, so you'll be starting a brand new study with us in this book of Matthew. So join us and start the New Testament with Matthew and for us. And again, if you want to be part of our Bible studies, email us at info@onefaithonechrist.org, and we'll send you the link to it. Join us at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, and let us study together. Also, as part of your journey with Christ, is you need to start talking to him. We have a prayer meeting on Thursdays, but you need to pray your daily prayers and speak to Lord Jesus yourself. You now have a relationship. How many relationships exist when you don't talk to them? Your husband, wife, your son, daughter, your girlfriend, boyfriend. If you don't communicate with them, that relationship is broken. So Jesus says he wants to have a relationship with you. So you have your prayer, and then we have our Thursday night prayer meetings. That's a conference call. The number there is 657-390-4716. That's for the United States. And if you are have prayers that you want to send us ahead of time that we will tee up for Thursdays, email them at info@onefaithonechrist.org, and we will add them to our prayer request. And if you want to, if they're important and they need to be prayed right now, as soon as we get the email, we will pray for them. Let us know if you want us to call you and pray with you on this before Thursdays. You don't have to wait till Thursdays. You can also call me at my number. If you go to our website, you'll find my number, and we can pray for you right then and there. Okay? Prayer is important, and we want to make sure that you are prayed up and your issues are being presented to God. So if you want, we have our Thursdays prayer meeting. If the United States, there's a number there, 657-390-3716. And if you're international, here are some of the countries that have asked for our prayer number. These are the numbers for your particular country. If you're one of these countries, email us at info@onefaithonechrist.org, and we will send you the access code that is needed to join the conference at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. And if you're a new country, let us know at info@onefaithonechrist.org, and we'll add you to the list and send you the number and access code as well. So like I mentioned, this is our communion service day as well as Palm Sunday. So now we're getting to the communion service. And so I wanted to read to you from 1 Corinthians 11. And we're going to start at verse 23. And it's basically the institution for the Lord's Supper. This is what Jesus Christ gave to the disciples to perform what we call communion service today. So 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my body, in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So now we're going to do our communion service here. And for those of you on the other side of the camera, get your wine, your drink, your cracker, your bread, whatever you want to utilize for bread and drink to perform this Lord's Supper with us, communion supper, as we might call it, with us together. So Lord God, we come to you and thank you, Lord, for this service today. And as we conclude this service, Heavenly Father, with this commemoration of Lord Jesus, that we do this, Lord God, as often as we do, to show our love and appreciation for Jesus till his return because of his death on the cross for us and his resurrection and his ascension into heaven. Father God, bless this communion service and bless each individual that's participating in it, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name. So for those who would like to participate in communion service today, come up and take a cup, which is our both combined cup and bread. And Father, look upon each and every one that you, Lord, govern and grace them, Heavenly Father, as they partake of this communion service, that they do so with the love and grace in their hearts that you have for us. You continue to abide within us, to grow us and become, Heavenly Father, all that we need to be and do as you govern us and guide us. And Father, we just thank you for your wonderful blessings and grace upon our lives. Bless this service in Jesus' name. Amen. Now here at our church, we have this little all-in-one thingy, so let's wait for everyone to open theirs. And you on the other side of our cameras, as you're getting, or hopefully you've gotten yours as well. Is everybody ready? Will, you okay? Good, okay. And like we just read, Jesus, during the supper, he took the bread and he broke it. And he prayed to God and he looked up and said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat. And at the end of supper, he took the cup and said, this is my blood, which is drained for you on the new covenant. Take and drink. And after that, they all sang a hymn and went home. So, Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your love and grace. Give us, Heavenly Father, safe passage to our destination. And as we leave here, but never your presence, Heavenly Father, may the peace of God, excuse me, guide and direct our hearts through Christ Jesus as we all sing together. Amen. God bless. What's that? Yeah. It's not 1 year. Yeah, I know. All right.